笑顔でやるときじゃないでしょうか。こう怖い顔してなきゃ。
Mr. Miyazaki is saying that because the topic matter is quite serious, he wonders if he should try to keep from smiling, if he should scowl and look ferocious.
Yeah.
Yeah.
じゃあ始まりましょうか。
はい、いいですよ。
Okay, well, welcome along everybody to our slightly analog press conference. I hope everybody can hear me. If you can't, you're doing something wrong with your earpiece because I can hear myself, which is a bit weird. Thanks so much for coming all the way out in this baking heat to Studio Ghibli. Of course, the man sitting beside me here barely needs an introduction, but we'll give one for the benefit of people outside who are watching this on live stream, and we understand there are quite a few. Hayao Miyazaki has directed some of Japan's most critically acclaimed movies of the last three decades. His Oscar-winning Spirited Away remains the top-grossing film in Japanese history. He has been dubbed Japan's Walt Disney, and his studio is sometimes polled Japan's best-loved brand. He's now 74, a very sprightly 74, and he's winding down a legendary career, but he is not going quietly into the night. His final film, The Wind Rises, is widely regarded to have made explicit his longtime anti-war politics and his concern that Japan is drifting away from its post-war pacifism. Around the time of its release, Miyazaki-san declared his support for Japan's war-renouncing constitution. He was also critical of the behavior of Japan's Imperial Army and said Japan should apologize. Nationalists vilified him as a traitor and, bizarrely, as anti-Japanese, considering his status in his home country. Miyazaki-san is currently focusing some of his energy on Okinawa, home to a bitter dispute over the construction of a new U.S. military base off the fishing village of Henoko, of course. The director says that Okinawa's demilitarization is essential to the creation of a peaceful East Asia. In May, he became one of the key backers behind the Henoko Fund, which aims to collect donations to stop the base from being built. He is going to talk for a couple of minutes about the Henoko Fund and the purpose of it, but very unusually for someone at the FCCJ, our guest speaker, he wants the entire presser to be made up mainly of questions. So if you could all think of your questions in advance, that'd be wonderful. So we have almost an hour entirely made up of your questions, unscripted, to the director. Can I just remind you, please, a couple of bookkeeping things. Can you switch off your cell phones? Can you make sure your receivers are tuned? And when you ask a question, if you could stand up, please, and just wait for the microphone to come to you, Chung-san or somebody else will bring around a portable mic. And I think that's it. Sensei, お願いします。
はい。簡単にすみません。まとめさせていただきます。今日は非常にアナログ的な記者会見ということで、ちょっと珍しいスタイルでございますが、暑い中でお越しいただきましてありがとうございます。まあ、私の隣に座っております、宮崎監督は本当に紹介不要ということでございます。まあ、非常に有名な方でございまして、たくさんの賞をいただいているわけでございます。しかしながら、引退、まあ、公式引退の後、やはり、その、安保政策に関しまして声を出すようになっているわけでございます。非常に強い平和主義者でありますので、そしてまた憲法を守るべきである、そしてまた戦争中 その帝国軍はやったことは間違ってたと言っておりますし、やはりその謝罪もすべきだとも言っております。そういう言葉を発することにおきまして、売国道 とも言われたりしているんでございますが、あるいは、反日とも言われているわけでございますが、最近の、その活動といたしましては、沖縄の辺野古問題について深く関わり始めているわけでございます。この5月に辺野古基金、辺野古ファンドに参加することになっております。まあ、今日は本当は冒頭ゲストスピーカーの方がいろいろお話して、それから質疑応答に移るんでございますが、今日は珍しく初めから質疑応答ということでございますので、約1時間たくさんのご質問をお受けできるということでございます。またここでいくつかお願いがあるんでございますが、携帯電話必ず切っていただきたいということでございます。そして今日はスピーカーなどを使っておりませんので、皆さんヘッドセットを使っていただきたいということでございます。ご質問がある方、誰かがマイクを持ってきますので、お待ちいただければと思います。
どうも暑い中ご苦労様です。話し出すと長くなりますから、ご質問に答えた方がいいと思いますので、どんなことでも構いませんからおっしゃってください。
So hello, as I was mentioned, first of all, I'd like to thank you very much for coming in spite of the terrible heat. And when I start speaking, I tend to speak in a very, very long way. So rather than my taking up all of your time, I would rather that you ask anything that you would like, and I would like to try to respond to them. Thank you. To your questions. Thank you.
Okay, well, we're all a bit surprised because we're so used to politicians coming and boring us for 30 minutes at a time at the club. So there we go. Questions, please.
非常にびっくりする嬉しいお話でございます。だいたい政治家は30分ぐらい最初話してしまって、ほとんど質疑応答の時間は残してくださらないので、今日は大変嬉しい会見となります。
It's going to be first. And the microphone is over there. どうぞ。
はじめまして。ありがとうございました。中国ビジネス誌の張と申します。はい。今回は少しずつ質問がありますので、お願いします。一つ目は、引退以降は宮崎監督はどんな生活を送っていますか。
はい、今それ答えるんですか。
はい、一つ目です。
Excuse me, my name is Joe and I have several questions, so I'd like to ask them one by one. First of all, what kind of daily life have you been leading since your retirement?
僕は以前と何も変わっていません。ただ来る時間が30分ほど遅くなり、帰る時間が30分ほど早くなっています。
So the only difference is that I come to work 30 minutes later than I did before, and I go home 30 minutes earlier than I did before. That's the only difference in my daily schedule.
Next question.
新しい水中のアニメも作っています。
これからかかるところです。今かかりつつあります。はい。
So I'm involved in some projects for animation, and I'm just beginning to become involved. I'm sorry, I couldn't quite hear the question, but that seems to be the answer.
Just to remind you, if you could keep to one question for now. If we have more time, you know, obviously we'll open it up. But because there's a lot of people, a lot of questions, let's keep it to one for the time being. Jake.
Jake Adelstein, Los Angeles Times. I don't think this is working out.
It is.
No, it's not.
No, you can hear it.
Oh, you can hear it. Oh, I'm sorry. Your film depicts the militarization of Japan and the growth of the military industry and the damage it does. Now, under the Abe regime in the last 2 years, Japan has become a huge producer of modern weapons and is exporting weapons and arms that they haven't done for years. And they look set to produce even more with changes in the law. How do you feel about that, based on your studies of what you did for...Your current movie.
はい、ロサンゼルスタイムズのものでございます。今まで多くの映画を通しまして、日本の軍事化、まあ、戦前の軍事化をテーマとして取り上げられたわけでございます。そしてまた軍事産業が最近の風たちのですかね、におきまして、その軍事産業がどんどん発達していることを取り上げたわけでございますので、いろいろリサーチもされたかと思います。この過去2年間安倍政権の下で、兵器の製造、また輸出の動きがどんどん活発化されているわけでございますし、また法律の変更によりまして、これがさらに活発化すると思うんでございますが、これについてどう思われますでしょうか。
非常に残念なことだと思っています。
I think it's a very, very unfortunate development.
Susan.
シンガポープレス の日本特派員と申します。ありがとうございました。宮崎監督はこの前も沖縄の辺野古に関する協力声明を出しました。その後は進展はどういうふうになっているか、または宮崎先生にとってはその後に嫌がらせとかはありましたか？
So, in regard to Okinawa, I think you took part in a joint declaration that was produced regarding the situation in Henoko. Have there been any developments since the issuing of that declaration? And on a personal note, have you received any any kind of nastiness or nasty responses as a result of your participation?
沖縄の人の過半数以上が辺野古に基地を作ることに反対しています。それでまだそれは最終結論は出ていませんが、これから困難な道が続くんだろうと思います。ですから、それでも永続的に長く続けるために辺野古基金を作って、あらゆることをしていこうというのが、このファンドの目的です。これもう一つ何でしたっけ？
何か直接の嫌がらせはございましたでしょうか？
それはありません。直接の嫌がらせはありません。それよりもこっそり寄ってきて、ありがとうという人が何人もいました、うん、なぜこっそり寄ってくるのか分かりません。堂々と来ればいいのにと思いましたけど、家内は私がその代表に共同代表になった時にそれまで何も言いませんでしたが、その丸をつけてその返信する時にとても喜んでくれました。
First of all, I believe that it's very, very clear what the situation in Okinawa is. More than half of the population are against the building of the Henoko facility. Of course, we don't have a final conclusion yet as to what will happen, but I think all the people involved are facing a difficult road ahead. It's a very, very long-term issue, but that is why this Henoko fund was developed, so that people that were against the building of this facility would do everything in their power to try to stop its realization. In regard to your second question about whether someone had been nasty to me or said negative words to me or done anything bad to me in any way, I have not received any kind of negative response whatsoever. However, people have come to me and whispered in my ear very softly, thank you so much for doing this. And I kind of wonder why they feel they have to whisper this and why they can't say it in a very open manner. On another note, my wife, when I received this request to join the Henoko Fund, made no comment to me whatsoever. However, when I finally put my seal on the document and said, yes, I would very much like to participate, she said she was very proud of me and she was very glad.
I'm going to take the opportunity to ask my one question, which the director has asked me to put to him. This week is a very important week for Japan. We have a number of security bills which are about to be put to the vote this week on the 16th, I believe, July 16th. In Parliament. The government of Shinzo Abe says that these bills are vital to protecting Japan. I wonder if Sensei can give us his view on this process.
私の方から監督からぜひ聞いてもらいたいと、っていう質問を聞かせていただきます。今週、日本はにとっては大変重要な1週間でございます。国会の方で重要な安保法制についてその議論が進みまして、16日だと思うんでございますが、採決される、という見通しになっております。安倍政権はこの安保法制は非常に重要である、日本のその安全保障を確保するために必要であると主張しているわけでございますが、監督はこれについてどう思われますでしょうか。
話が飛ぶようですが、イラク戦争が起こったときに、日本のテレビジョンで、あるイギリスの政治学者がインタビューに答えていました。
I know it sounds as though I'm not quite answering your question, but I would like to talk about something that happened in the past. When the Iraq war first broke out, there was a political analyst, a political scientist from the United Kingdom who appeared on Japanese television.
その内容をかいつまんでお話しますと、この戦争の結果、アメリカは、アフガニスタンとイラクから自分の牧場に帰ることになるでしょう、そして世界は一段と混乱するでしょうと言いました。
自分の牧場
へ帰る。
He said many, many things, but to just give a quick summary of his, the salient points of his comments, he said that as a result of this war, he said that eventually the United States would return to their own pastures after their experiences in Afghanistan and Iraq, and the world would then be thrown into even greater turmoil.
今安倍政権のやってることはそのことを考えてどういう方法を取るかということだと思います。私はその正反対の方向がいいと思いますが、つまり軍事力でその中国の膨張を止めようとするのは不可能だと思います。もっと違う方法を考えなければいけないと、そのために私たちは平和憲法を作ったんだと思っています。それはその考えは変わっていません。
In other words, I believe that Prime Minister Abe should keep these comments, ideas very much in mind as he moves forward with his policies. What I'm saying is that I think the direction in which he is moving is the exact opposite of the direction that he should be moving. In other words, he is trying very much to be able to hold down the growing military might of China, the expansion of China by using military force. But I think that is an impossible task. It is simply not going to be possible to realize.In fact, it is the understanding that we had that such things are not possible that led to the formation, I believe, of our pacifist constitution.
Thank you. That's Isabel.
Isabel Reynolds from Bloomberg. I'd like to ask about Prime Minister Abe's planned statement on the 70th anniversary of the war next month.What would you like him to say in that statement?
はい、ブルームバーグの記者でございます、来月予定されております、70周年談話でございますね、はい、安倍首相の、このについてどうお考えでございますでしょうか。どういうような内容を盛り込んでいただきたいと思われますでしょうか。
その談話はですね、中国の現在の政治情勢、経済情勢、それから日本における政治情勢や経済情勢の反映であって、その精神は歴史に学ぶということから随分離れていると思います。ですからあんまり期待していません。
I believe that what should be included in the 70th anniversary statement is our comments that reflect the present reality, the present political reality and the present economic reality of both Japan and China. In other words, I think it should reflect what is happening today. And I believe that these ideas are very, very different from what Prime Minister Abe has been saying in the past, which is a reflection or a preoccupation with history.
Richard?
Richard Lloyd Parry of The Times. One of the things that always strikes me about Shinzo Abe is that he's very unpopular in opinion polls on big issues like nuclear, even security bills. But he continues to win general elections very decisively. And one of the reasons for that seems to be the failure of the left, the liberal left in Japan.And so I wanted to ask you that as a Japanese creator and intellectual from the liberal left who is politically engaged, why is it that the Japanese left has failed to produce a political leadership capable of seriously challenging the nationalist right?
イギリスのタイムズ氏でございます、はい、私はその新蔵安倍新蔵氏を考えますときには非常によくわからない部分があるのでございます。なぜならば例えば大きなテーマに関して、例えばその原発に関してなどの世論調査の結果を見ますと、彼の人気は非常に低いわけでございます、はい、しかしながらその大きな選挙におきましては彼は必ず非常に強く勝つわけでございます。でそれはその一つの理由はやはりその日本の、まあ、左翼というんでしょうか、リベラル派の方たちはあんまり強くないという現状があるのではないかと思います。監督もクリエイターでございます、またインテリでございますし、まあ、どっちかといえばそのリベラル派に属していらっしゃると思うのでございますが、なぜ日本の、 その、まあ、左側 の、 その方たちは大きなその政治的な力というのをなかなか形成できないと思いますでしょうか。
民主党の最初の総理はこの沖縄の基地の問題についても 日本全体で背負うべきであって沖縄だけに負担させるのは間違いであるというふうにはっきり言った方です。でもたちまち党内の、勢力争いの中で引きずり下ろされてしまいました。そしてその後地震と原発と立て続けに最悪が見舞ってですね、その混乱の中でとうとう自民党政権がずっとやりたくてもやれなかった消費税を民主党が決める羽目になってしまったんです。この結果ですね、長い政治的な無力感と不信感がこの国にはびこったんだと思います。自民党は過半数以上の支持を得たのではなくて多くの人間が投票しなかったことによって天下を取ったんです。ですからこれはまた変わります。永続的なものではないと思います。その安倍首相は自分が憲法の解釈を変えた偉大な男として歴史に残りたいと思っているんだと思いますが、愚劣なことだと僕は思っています。
As you remember, the first prime minister that was produced by the DPJ, the Democratic Party, was a man who said some very true things, which was that he focused national attention on the Okinawa base problem, and he said that the U.S. bases should not be a burden that is borne simply by the Okinawans, but it should be something that should be borne by all of Japan. It's not right. It is wrong to push everything on only the Okinawans. However, because of internal power struggles within the party, he was basically dragged down from the top post. And in addition to this, the DPJ was very, very unfortunate in that Japan happened to be hit by two terrible disasters, which was the earthquake and the tsunami and also the nuclear power plant accident. They were faced with the most direst of situation, and in the resulting confusion, they were basically put into an untenable position of being forced to accept the raise in the consumption tax, which was actually a long-held dream of the LDP. As a result of all of these developments, I believe that there settled within the Japanese population a feeling of despair and hopelessness and mistrust about the political system. So when you say that the LDP won many, many seats or won the majority in the elections, it's not that they won so much, it's just so many, it is rather that so many people did not even go out to vote. However, I believe that this is not a permanent situation by any chance, by any in any way, and so that things will change. I believe that Prime Minister Abe will leave his mark on history as being a very great man who went and changed the interpretation of the Constitution.
Thank you. I see this lady here.
Singapore Channel News Asia の石田道夫と申します。今日宮崎先生がですね、こう海外メディアの前で記者会見をされているわけなんですけれども、一番今海外のメディアに伝えたいことは何なのか教えていただけますでしょうか。
I'm from the Singapore Press. I would like to ask, you are taking this rather extraordinary opportunity to speak before the foreign press. What is the strongest message that you wish to send to the foreign press?
私はこの役目、つまり辺野古基金の共同代表という人間としてここに臨んでおりますから、その辺野古の基地の問題、沖縄の人々が基地を撤去したいと思っているそのことをお伝え願えたら本当に嬉しいと思います。
As you know, I'm here in my capacity as one of the joint representatives of the辺野古 Fund. Therefore, I would like very much to fulfill this role, which is to try to convey to as many people as possible the reality facing the Okinawans today, the problem of the U.S. bases there, and how much the Okinawa people want those bases removed.
それからもう一つ、先ほどの方の質問でしたが、日本と中国の問題についての共同声明についてですね、私は侵略戦争が完全な間違いで多大な損害を中国の人々に与えたことについて深く反省しているということを明言しなければいけないと思っている人間です。それを政治的な駆け引きとして双方で何かごちゃごちゃやるのは本当に良くない。あらゆる政治情勢と関係なく、この日本は長期にわたる中国大陸におけるその愚劣な行為について深く反省しなければいけないと思っています。それを忘れたがっている人がいっぱいいることは知っていますが、忘れてはいけないことです。
So I'd like to also add one more comment, which has to do with the previous question, and this is about the joint declaration with China and Japan, or rather probably the 70th anniversary statement by the Prime Minister. I would hope very much that he would include very clear phrases in that statement that Japan feels great remorse, hansei, for the tremendous suffering that it inflicted during the past war to the people of China. This was, after a war, after all, a war of aggression. I think that should be clearly stated. I know that presently, as to the correct wording, as to the final wording included in the statement, there are many kinds of political dealings and negotiations going on, but I think this is the kind of thing that should have no political sort of considerations, but it should just be a simple expression of remorse for this terrible thing that was done by Japan in the past. I know that many people want to forget what happened in the past, but this is not something that should be forgotten.
I was just going to say, could I ask a question about the interpretation?
Yeah.
Not of that answer, but the previous one.
Right.
The words I wrote down in English for the last sentence were, Abe will go down in history as a very great man who changed the interpretation of the Constitution. Can I double check that?
さっきの通訳の内容を確認したいということでございますが、先ほど首相安倍首相がその憲法を解釈の解釈を変更した偉大な人として、まあ、歴史に残ってもらいたいということ
残りたいと思ってるんです。
残りたいと思ってるんです。
本人が思ってるんです。残りたいと思ってるんです。でも残らないでしょう。
So excuse me, the interpreter did not quite get it right. He probably wants to be remembered in that way, and I think I said it was some kind, he said it was some kind of sarcasm, and the sarcasm didn't go get through in the translation.
ちょっと話をさせてください。この紙切れが私のところに突然届いたんです。ここには辺野古基金について、共同代表や就任についての依頼状です。それともう一枚依頼承諾する承諾しないに丸をつけろという紙が入っていました。で、私はその共同代表になるような資格やその能力を持っていないので本当に当惑したんです。ただですね、沖縄の問題というのはここにいればなかなか伝わってきませんが、実は自分の大事な友人に沖縄の人がおりまして、その人がですね、1972年の沖縄返還の年です。5月1日に返還になりましたが、4月28日に、東京の大学に入るためにパスポートとそれから注射の黄色い紙と言いましたが、伝染病の予防注射だと思いますけど、その黄色い紙を持って東京にやってきた。で、その時にその人間が感じたありとあらゆる抑えた、非常に抑えられた、感想でしたが、その時の話を思い出すと、私は沖縄の人にものすごく申し訳ないと思っています。ですから、この共同代表を引き受けることにしました。
So I'm holding in my hand, and I've just shown to you a letter that was sent to me, and it was a letter that was asking me to join in this Henoko Fund as one of the joint representatives, Kyoto Daiho. I was offered one of two options, to accept or to decline. And I felt that since I live so far away from Okinawa, Okinawa seems a different world when you live in Tokyo, and I also did not feel that I had any special authority or background or right or special abilities to be able to take on such a task. I struggled with myself for some time before making a decision. But the reason that I decided finally to accept was that I remembered the experiences of a very dear friend of mine who came from Okinawa. He came actually to Okinawa in 1972. He came from Okinawa to the mainland to attend university in 1972. You may recall that this is the year that Okinawa was returned to the mainland. He came on April 28th, but Okinawa was officially returned to Japan on May 1st. So he still needed to have a passport. He needed to have a piece of yellow paper that showed that he had had all of the required inoculations, shots, to get into the country, to get into the mainland. And at that time, all of the feelings that he had kept bottled up, they all came forth because he was being treated in a very special way. And when I think about his experiences, and I remember them again, and I think about all of the suffering that the Okinawa people have had for experienced for so many years, I just feel such tremendous feeling of the word is moshiwakenai, which is very difficult to translate, but I'm sure you all know it means that there are no apologies enough in the world that I can express that would express the feelings that I have. And so I felt that the least that I could do was take on this task.
Let's just go first to people who haven't asked questions before, yeah? So I think I saw Teddy's hand earlier, and then this lady here, yeah? Teddy?
よろしくお願いします。ビデオニュースドットコムの神保と申します。今回沖縄の話もそれから先ほど安保法制の話も出ましたが、いずれもですね、政府は、アメリカとの関係上それが非常に必要なんだという立場を取っているというふうに理解しています。監督は今の日米関係、アメリカとの関係ですね、特に今の政府の下での日米関係についてはどのようにお考えでしょうか。このままでいいのか、もっとこうあるべきかというところがあれば教えてください。
I'm from Video News, and the most of the conversation has been about the upcoming security legislation and the Okinawa issue. And both, of course, have to do with the relationship between Japan and the United States. So, Mr. Miyazaki, when you look at the current relationship between the United States and Japan, how do you view it? Do you think things should stay the same? Do you think it should be changed? And if so, how?
それについて、つまり僕はアメリカに非常に大事な友人たちが随分いるんです。極めて誠実な本当に友情の厚い友達ですが、アメリカの文化は僕は好きではありません。アメリカの生活様式も日本に多く浸透しているいろいろな生活のやり方も基本的に好きじゃない人間なので、そういう色眼鏡だけで見てしまいます。今具体的にどういう方針をめぐってどうなのかということをここで述べることはできませんが、僕はいつか大量消費文明に終わりが来るだろうという予感の中で生きていますので、それでご勘弁してください。
So, in regard to the United States, I have many friends in the United States that I have very deep friendships with, that I believe are full of sincerity and have beautiful, pure hearts. They are precious friends for me. Having said this, however, I fundamentally am a person that does not like the culture of the United States. I fundamentally do not care for the daily way of living that the United States follows, and that daily way of living has crept very much into Japanese society now, and I am very much against that. I therefore tend to look at anything related to the United States through those rather what I call colored glasses, and with those kinds of preconcepts, preassumptions. So I'm not really going to comment on very difficult political or other ramifications. However, I would just like to simply say that I believe that eventually the civilization that we see in the world where people consume and dispose of things in great amounts, large amounts, I think that kind of civilization will eventually come to an end.
This lady here.
And then Joel.
AP 通信の山口と申します。よろしくお願いします。今週 の安全保障関連法案も多くの国民はよく説明がわからないと言っていますし、憲法学者のほとんども違憲だと言っている、そういう中で強制的に採決されようとしているという、内容ももちろんのこと、その決め方についても疑問視されているんですけれども、そしてまた自民党の一部 の会合で沖縄の新聞に対するそのいろんな発言もありましたし、少しずつその民主主義が壊れていっているのではないかというふうに感じている人もいるんじゃないかと思うんですが、監督もそう映画を作りになるという、表現をするという方のお立場として、今のこの状況をどういうふうにお感じになっているか教えていただけますか。
I'm from AP, and in regard to the security bills that are now being debated in the Diet, many people are saying in society that they do not really understand what is happening, and they do not understand the contents of these bills, and vast majority of constitutional experts are saying that the current bills are in violation of the Constitution. In spite of this, because the ruling parties have a majority, they seem prepared to steamroll the bills through the Diet. So not only in regard to the contents, but in regard to how the bills are being passed, I think there are many people in society that feel great anxiety and feel that have many questions in their head about this. And also the fact that recently there was a meeting within the LDP where some of the Okinawa papers were criticized and perhaps many harsh words were said about them. So many people in society seem to feel that democracy itself is beginning to break down in Japan. Mr. Miyazaki, as a person who is involved in the creative arts and who believes in freedom of expression, what are your thoughts?
もともとその程度のレベルの人たちなんです。それが自分たちが数が多いと思ってのさばって姿を現しただけだと思います。
I believe that what you're seeing happening today is that politicians who are basically were of a low level, they're true nature has come forth because now they have the numbers to not hold anything back. In other words, literally what Mr. Miyazaki is saying is that they were originally of such low quality or low level people. It's just that because they are in such great numbers that you can see their true colors now. I apologize if that wasn't a very good answer. It's one that fills me with great sadness, actually.
I quite liked it. Joel?
Thank you. My name is Joël Lejean from TV5 France and RTL. My question is about the sense of being Japanese. In The Wind Rises, you have described a nature of your mind, which is to be very pacifist and anti-war. Some people didn't see it like that.Some people thought you were talking about the beauty of militarization and something like that, and you corrected the image after that, of course. My question is about what is it to be Japanese? Many years ago, a French TV reporter asked to Mishima, what is it to be Japanese? And he said to be invisible. And I would like to ask you, what is it, the true essence of being Japanese, as you've been criticized to be anti-Japanese? Thank you.
フランスのテレビのものでございます、日本人というものは何であるでしょうかというような質問でございますが、風立ちぬにおきましては、やはり最初は、監督の意図といたしましては、非常にその平和主義的なその考え方を打ち出していたと思うんでございますが、やっぱり中ではその誤解する方もいたと思うんです。その軍事を軍事的なことを美化しているというような受け止め方もあったと思うのでございますが、あとのいろんなお話の中でそうではないということをご説明されていると思うのでございますが、結局日本人であるということはどういうことなのかというのを基本的に聞きたいんでございます。昔フランスの記者が三島由紀夫にも同じ問いをしたところ、透明であること、直訳しました、透明であること、インビジブルであることが日本人であることだと言ったんですが、監督はどうお考えでしょうか。
僕は、社会の右側の端っこにいる島の人間たちで、平和に暮らせるはずの人間たちなんです。僕はそれだけです。ここの水と緑とで、資源といったら米が取れるぐらいでした。でも今僕らがやっている日本でやってる生活というのは、よそからかき集めてきて、それを使い尽くしていくという、そういう生活です。それは長く続かないでしょう。日本人であるということはどういうことかというのは、僕にはよく分かりません。分かりませんが、本当の知恵は、必要な知恵は、世界の隅っこで、ひそやかに行こうという、いようというのが、一番正しいと僕は思っています。
I believe that we are a people that live on a small island or set of islands on the far reaches of the earth, and we should be a people that are able to live peacefully in our small corner of the earth. After all, we have water, we are blessed with great greenery and nature. We don't have great resources, but we have enough resources to be able to produce our main staple, rice. I believe, in other words, that the present current modern lifestyle that we see in Japan is basically the result of bringing together many, many things, aspects of lifestyles from around the world. And we go through each new lifestyle very, very quickly and throw them away. And this kind of living, I think, is unsustainable in the long run. In regard to your question, what it is to be Japanese, a sense of being Japanese, I really do not know how to answer that question. I don't know what the answer is. But I believe that we do possess the wisdom, and or we should possess the wisdom, to be able to live in our corner of the earth, way at the edges of the world, in peace.
Jake.
まあ、日本語で聞きます。まあ、いろいろ聞きたいこともあるしね、最近安倍ちゃんの声を聞くたびに岸信介が蘇ってきたような気もしますよね。特定秘密保護法もあるし、軍事産業もやってるし、平和憲法も撤回を求めてるから、はい、もう本当になんか岸蘇ってるのかな、この生きるようだと思うんだけど、まあ、もう一つのひどい政策の中で、最近ね、文部科学省が全ての尋問社会科学を廃止する方針を打ち出しました。それ文学、社会学、心理学、その方針についてはどう思いますかと、なぜそういう方針を打ち出したのか。
So I have many new questions. I'd like to ask my question in Japanese. I have many, many questions. Whenever I hear Mr. Abe talk about things, I feel as though I'm hearing Mr. Kishi's voice again. Whether it's the secrecy bill, whether it's destroying the or impairing the revising the peaceful constitution, or whether it's reviving the military industry. Many things fill me with great anxiety. But in particular, I'd like to ask about the policy announced by the Ministry of Education, MEXT. In other words, that they have said that they want to eliminate the humanities, the study of the humanities, culture, psychology, et cetera, et cetera. What do you think about this decision, and why do you think it arose?
歴史というものに対する感覚がひどく鈍くなっているんだと思います。歴史。今歴史のある場所にいるんだという感覚がひどく鈍くなっていて、このままずっと続くんだろうみたいな感じがこの国の中に蔓延しているんだと思いますね。
I think that right now many people in Japan have lost their sense of where they are in the long history of the human race. In other words, their ideas or their sensibilities in regard to history have been dulled over time. They can only see the present, and they think that the present will continue.
第二次大戦の後、日本は冷戦の狭間で、その保守と革新というのは、その民主主義か社会主義かという、そういう冷戦構造の中で揺れ動いてきたんです。それが冷戦が終了した後ですね、つまりソ連が崩壊した後、そのはっきりしたこう根拠を、そのつまり、保守と革新を分ける根拠を失ったんだと思います。それが、その再建がまだ革新の側にできてないんだと思いますよ。
I believe that after World War II, as you know, the Cold War began, and Japan was very much caught up in the conflicts of the Cold War. Japan basically divided itself politically into two camps, one the conservative camp, which said that they represented the forces of democracy, and one the progressives, the reformists, who basically were represented by the socialists. And it was this structure, this double structure that continued for many, many years. However, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, there is no longer much justification for this division. And although the conservatives seem to have found their place in society, the other camp still has not.
Thank you. I'm going to take a question from the back because, Richard, you've had one. Then we'll come back to you. Yeah?
I'm Daniel Eskenazi, freelance journalist from Switzerland. The first nuclear power plant is going to be restarted anytime soon. I would like to have your opinion about the nuclear energy in Japan and should it be abandoned?
スイスのフリーの記者でございます。原発でございますが、近々再稼働、第1号がまた再稼働されるというお話になっております。原発をどうお考えでございますでしょうか。日本はそれを放棄すべきだと思いますでしょうか。
ええ、こんな地震だらけで火山だらけの国で原発なんて持ってるのかです。
I think absolutely we should abandon nuclear energy. After all, we are a land of earthquakes and volcanoes. Of course, we should abandon them.
この土地だって本当にわずかの前に火山の噴火でできた土地ですから。私は、東京と埼玉の間に住んでいますが、そこの、川沿いの、小さな土地にいますけど、実は東京湾に、津波か高潮が襲ってきた場合ですね。東京都のハザードマップによると、私の家も沈没することになっています。そのスケールたるや壮絶なスケールなんです。そういうことが起こりうる、いや、起こるだろうと確実に、そういう国に私たちいるんです。で、ここも津波が来るかという話になると、ここは意見の分かれるところですが、友人たちは多くそんなことはないだろうと言いますけど、でも実際富士山はいつかは爆発して巨大な阿蘇山のような形になるはずですから、この国は本当にわからないんです。わからないということを前提に生きなきゃいけないところなんです。そんなところで原発なんか持ってのほかです。ましてですね、沖縄を何のために基地にするかって言ったら、それは中国の封じ込めのための最前線でしょ。だけど、なぜアメリカが海兵隊をガムに持ってこうとしてるかって、最前線に最強部隊を置くことはできないんですよ。だってパールハーバーもクラークフィールドも、そこに最強の基地があったから日本海軍は攻撃したんです。必ずそうなりますから、沖縄をその拠点にすることはもはやアメリカの戦略上でも良くないことになってるはずです。ベトナム戦争の時とは違うんです。ですから辺野古に基地を作っても結局それは自衛隊が使うことになるんでしょう。そういうことも含めて考えると僕は辺野古のその埋め立ての基地を作るのは反対です。本当にそこは標的を作るようなものですというのも入ってます。
After all, we must remember that the land on which we are sitting today was actually made many, many years ago, but not so long ago in terms of geological time by a volcano. In fact, I live on the border between Tokyo and Saitama. I live along the river. And if we look at the hazard map that is issued by the city, we see that if a huge earthquake were to occur and a huge tsunami were to come to Tokyo Bay, then my house would beCompletely flooded, completely overwhelmed by such a tsunami. The kind of disaster, the devastation that would ensue is almost unimaginable, impossible to consider. In fact, when we talk about the place where we're sitting today, whether a tsunami would actually reach here, opinions are divided. Some friends insist that yes, something good, terrible could happen. Some people say no, a tsunami can't get this far. But the point is, we don't know. And it's very, very possible that eventually, not only possible, but it's almost certain that eventually Mount Fuji will erupt in a very large way again. But the point is that we don't have certainty about these things, but there's a very likely possibility that something disastrous will happen. And therefore, we should live accordingly. We should live according to the fact that there are these risks available. And I would like to go back again to the point about Okinawa. The whole point about building facilities in Okinawa, new facilities in Okinawa, is that we wanted, the American forces wanted to be Okinawa at the forefront, the front lines of any of conflict with China. However, you can see that the United States is beginning to change its policies and they want to move many of their troops to Guam, for example.They know that they really can't keep their top troops, their front line troops in Okinawa. It has to be in a different place. In other words, places that are In other words, the United States is changing its own strategy, and we must be very much aware of that. If we continue to build Hinako, eventually it will not be used so much by U.S. Marines, but rather by the Japanese self-defense forces. And when we consider Clark Air Force Base or Pearl Harbor, we see that these kinds of bases basically are the first places that are targeted when a conflict arises. In other words, that is one major reason why I'm against this Hinako facility, that you're basically creating a new target.
Thank you. I'm going to take Richard's question because he's had his hand up, and then gentleman at the back, yeah, and then the gentleman.
Thank you. You talked about your dislike of the culture of consumerism and waste in the United States, but of course your work, your films have been extremely successful in Hollywood, dubbed over with American voices, American actors, and I wondered if you could talk about the way in which your work is processed by Hollywood, and whether you ever feel that your message and the meaning of your work is changed or compromised in that translation. Thanks.
あの先ほどアメリカ の, そのまあ消費文化、大量消費文化などにあの非常に違和感を感じる、あまり好きじゃないとおっしゃったのでございますが、しかしながら、そのアメリカという国はあの監督の映画を大好きでございますし、あの非常にあの受け入れ、非常に成功しているわけでございます。もちろん、そうは言いましても、あのその映画そのものを直接見られているわけではなく、あのダビングされているわけでございます。あのアメリカ人の声優が入るわけでもありますので、質問でございますが、ハリウッドは監督の映画をどのようにプロセス処理しているんでございますでしょうか。つまりやはりその翻訳などを通しまして、あるいはそのプレゼンテーションを通しまして、何かその本来の意味、あの、その監督が、打ち出したいと、歌いたいと思っていた意味とかっていうのは少し変わっていると思いますでしょうか。変えられていると思いますでしょうか。
いや、アメリカに私たちの作品を紹介するについては、ピクサーのジョン・ラスターが非常にあの友情と責任を持ってやってくれています。ですから彼を私は信用しています。本当にあの一番の親友です。
In regard to your question, in the United States, our works are handled or distributed by Pixar, Mr. John Lasseter or Lasseter?
Lasseter.
And he is a person who has told us that, who told me that he values my friendship and he takes full responsibility for how our work is distributed. I trust him implicitly. He is one of my greatest friends.
あの、ついでにちょっと一つ。僕はイギリスの、そのアードマンスタジオというところに、ブリストルにあるアードマンスタジオというのがあるんですが、そこに行って、そのスタッフと交流したときにですね、あの、彼ら彼女たちがあのこの DVD にサインしてくれって私の作品を持ってきました。完全な海賊版でした。中国製のどういうふうになってるのか私には見当もつきません。
I would just like to add one comment, which was when I visited a place called Adman Studios in Bristol in the United Kingdom. We had some opportunities to chat with the staff there, and some of the women and men came to me and said, "Would you sign our DVD of your work?" And I looked at the DVD, and it was a completely pirated version. I do not know what exactly is happening.
Stefano.
My name is Stefano Carre for the Italian Economic Daily. You said that you are still very active, just a little less early in the morning, a little less in the evening. So could you tell us a little bit more about the creative project you are working on now, and maybe in the future you have an idea to make a big project and you are just elaborating now the idea. Thanks.
イタリアの経済誌のものでございます。先ほどあの引退をあの発表されてから生活があまり変わってない、まあ、30分早く来て30分早く30分遅く来て30分早く帰るという話だったのでございますが、今取り組んでいらっしゃいますそのクリエイティブなプロジェクトについてお話しいただけますでしょうか。そしてもしかしたら将来的にはまた大きなそのプロジェクトに関わりたいと今いろいろ悩んでらっしゃるんでございますでしょうか。考えてらっしゃるんでしょうか。
いや、あの今ジブリの美術館で短編映画を作っていますので、 その10作目を作にかかっています。でこれは、従来のスタッフ少しと、それから、CG の新しいスタッフたちと出会うことになっています。でプロデューサーは3年ぐらいかかるであろうと言ってますが、その若いスタッフを3年も拘束するのは良くないので、私はできるだけ早く終わらせたいと思っていますが、それだけでも精一杯ではないかとこう思っているんです。
So right now, as you know, we do produce short films to be screened at the Ghibli Museum, and we're working now on the 10th such film. It's a wonderful project in which I work with some of the staff that I've worked with for years, and also some new staff who come from the computer graphics world. The producer is saying it'll probably take 3 years to complete this new 10th film. However, I feel that 3 years out of the lives of a young staff member is too much. They should be given more freedom very quickly, so I want to finish it up as quickly as possible. Having said this, it is a very time-consuming and very energy-consuming, and right now I don't have the energy or time for anything else.
Thank you. I think this gentleman here was next, weren't you? Yeah. And then Martin.
My name is Patrick Walter, Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. I wonder, can you tell us, as regards your position on Hanako and the SDF in the United States, can you tell us, do you see China as a threat, and can you tell us what Japan, how Japan should deal with China and the rise of China and the militaristic rise of China?
フランクフルトの新聞のものでございます。辺野古、そして自衛隊、そしてまた米軍との関係でございますが、中国を脅威としてご覧になりますでしょうか。そして中国にどう対応すべきでしょうか。中国の台頭、そして中国のその軍事拡大政策などについてどう対応すべきだと思いますでしょうか。
中国は膨張せざるを得ない内圧を持っています。それをどういうふうに時間をかけてかわすかというのが日本の最大の政治的な課題だと思います。
I believe that China possesses a great internal pressure that propels them to continue to expand, and those internal pressures cannot be denied. And I think the greatest political challenge facing Japan is how to deal with this expansion over time. Was this not enough of an answer?
I see at the back. Yeah.
Sorry, it's
kind of Martin first. Yeah, I just forgot Martin.Martin first, then Isabel, yeah.
Martin Colling with the German Financial Daily Handelsblatt. Basically, I have two questions, but I'm only allowed to ask one.
Well, there's 10 minutes left.
Okay, then I will ask the political question. And I'm wondering about your view of the Japanese youth. It seems that many in other countries we see a swing to the right, even among young people.In Japan, also quite a few people, young people, voted for Tamogami in the elections. And I wonder what is happening, how you see what is happening in Japan. On the one hand, it seems very, the youth seems very unpolitical. On the other hand, there seems to be more right-wing views also among the young people. So how do you see the current situation, and what do you think?Will happen in the future with the young, among the young people. Are we maybe even about to see a more politicized discussions even among young people, or are these times over?
ドイツの新聞でございます。日本の若者をどう 見ていらっしゃいますでしょうか。まあ、他の国を見ますと、若い人たちの中でもやっぱりその右傾化という傾向が出てきているわけでございます。日本でもあの田母神氏も、まあ、大きな人気をあの若い人たちの中でもあの得てます。一方ではあの多くの若者はその政治に無関心というふうに言われているのでございますが、そう言ってもやっぱりその右寄りの若い人たちが結構 構増えているというふうに考えております。今後これはどういうふうにその発展すると思いますでしょうか。つまり過去のようなその若者が非常にその政治プロセスに非常にその熱狂的にその参加するようなあるいはというような時代が来ると思いますでしょうか。それともそういうことはないと思いますでしょうか。
スマホを手放してくれれば変わります。
If we can get the young people to give up their smartphones, I think we will see politicized discussions.
It's the
end.
Isabel Reynolds from Bloomberg again. My question is almost the opposite from the previous one. It's about Japan's pacifism. Pacifism came to Japan in the form of a constitution written by a foreign country, an occupying power. Why do you think it still has a relatively strong hold in Japan now, as you can see by the reaction to the current security bills?
私の質問は本当にさっきの質問と全く反対の質問になるわけでございます。この日本 その平和憲法というものは、やはりその外国の占領国が日本に押し付けたというふうによく言われているわけでございます。しかしながら今 その日本での動きを見ますと、この憲法は非常に日本人が非常に深く愛しているわけでございます。どうしてそういうふうに日本人はこの憲法をこんなに対して強い思いを持っていると思いますでしょうか。
15年にわたる日本の戦争はですね、惨憺たる経験を日本人にも与えたんです。300万人の死者です。この経験はその、多くのつまり私たちよりちょっと上の世代にとっては忘れがたいことです。それで平和憲法というのはそれに対する光が差し込むような体験だったんです。これは今の若い人には、若い日本人にはむしろ通じないぐらいの大きな力だったんです、平和憲法というのは。それで平和憲法は占領軍が押し付けたというよりも、1928年の不戦条約というのをその国際連盟を作るきっかけになったものですけども、その不戦条約のその精神を引き継いでいるもので、決して歴史的に孤立したものでも占領軍に押し付けられただけのものでもないんだと思います。
When we consider over 15 plus years when Japan was engaged in different wars and saw the loss of some 3 million lives, the tremendous devastation and suffering that the people of Japan experienced at that time was so terrible that when the constitution was presented to them or made theirs, it seemed as though it were a shaft of brilliant light shining down from the heavens. I mean, that's how wonderful the emergence of the peace constitution was for many, many Japanese, especially for people of a slightly older generation than myself who experienced many of the sufferings and travails and despair of the war directly. Having said all this, I know that for younger generations, this concept might be very, very difficult to understand. But, and I also understand that there are people who say that the constitution was pressed upon them. However, when we think that back in 1928, there was, when the, I guess it was the League of Nations that was established, there already was a treaty that was signed by many parties, which basically renounced war or as a way to resolve conflicts. And so this is a concept that existed before the peace constitution of Japan. In other words, we are simply continuing a concept that was widely accepted in the world. So I don't think it should be viewed as a constitution that was forcibly pressed upon the Japanese people.
Fu-san and then Wang-san. Is-
よく日本とアジアは理解できないという部分は日本の教科書の中では加害という部分をあまりも薄んでますので まさに最近の動きでは中国韓国も、まあ、日本に対する歴史認識を指摘をしているんですが私の質問では監督はたくさんのいい映画を作りましたのでまさにその思想も加害の部分も大変重く感じる日本のストーリーですので例えば将来的にはこのテキストを日本の国家 国がそういう支配できるようなテキストより自分が作った映画にアジアのそういう観点に関してもっと入れたり、またはそういうビジョンというのはありますか、またはアジアの人たちと共通な映画を作っていきたいとか、そういうようなことはお考えありませんか。
So, in regard to the problems that Japan faces with some other countries in Asia, there's quite often comments made to the effect that the people of Japan and other nations in Asia, they simply can't understand each other. And it has partly to do perhaps with the contents of Japanese textbooks because of the role of Japan as perpetrator of many, many atrocities during the war is not clearly necessarily explained in the textbooks. Countries such as South Korea and China have raised their voices about the fact that there's not enough deep understanding of history, historical truth by many people in Japan. The fact, however, that you, Mr. Miyazaki, have created wonderful films conveys clearly to your audiences that you do have an understanding of history and what of Japan's role as perpetrators in the war. Do you think that in the future that somehow your films could be expanded to include more of perhaps Asia's point of view, other Asian countries' points of views, and perhaps you might even consider working together to produce a joint film with other Asian nations?
アニメーション、まあ、いろんなアニメーションの作品が考えられますが、今私が作ろうとしている作品はこんな小さな毛虫の話です。その指でつつぐだけで死んでしまいます。この小さな毛虫がこんな小さな葉っぱにくっついている生活を描くつもりです。それはアニメーションが生命の本質的な部分に迫った方がアニメーションとしては表現しやすいんではないかと思っているからです。意味わかりませんか。それで100年や200年の短い歴史よりももっと長い何億年にもつながる歴史をアニメーションは描いた方がいいと思っています。
In regard to projects using animation, the work that I'm involved in can be equivalent to a little caterpillar. In other words, it is such a small thing that if one were to press on it hard with a finger, you could crush it. You could crush the life out of it. And I think, therefore, animation should understand its role and its abilities and its limitations, and it should focus on trying to just survive. And I think my caterpillar should just cling to this leaf and try to derive succulents from that. In other words, I believe that the animation does its best work when it focuses on the basics of life. I think that's the best way for it to express its ideas. And I also think that instead of trying to focus on short spans of history, 100 years or 200 years, I think we should focus on ideas that are much longer. For example, 100 million years, 200 million years. These are the themes that interest me.
Thank you. Now we're down to the last 2 minutes. Do we have do we have Sensei's permission to have an extra 5 minutes? Wang-san,
you can extend it for 5 minutes.ありがとうございました。最後の質問はアニメに戻ります。今までのアニメ制作につきまして、監督としてはまた実験していないこと、あるいは一貫なものがありますか。そしてオタク向けの作品はどんどん出てきたんですが、監督はどの状況にと思っていますか。ありがとうございます。
最後のところちょっとよくわからなかったんですけど、
オタクに向けて
ます。オタクSo, in regard to animation, you have been involved as a director and producer in many, many different works. Is there something that you haven't been able to complete, that something sort of has always been on the back burner, but you have not been able to complete? And there are some comments that your animation works are directed toward otakus, are very popular among otakus. What do you think about that? In other words, geeks.
フィルムがなくなって、私たちが使ってたセルもなくなって、絵の具で塗ることもなくなりました。それからバックグラウンド、背景を描くときの絵の具を私たちはポスターカラーを使ってきましたが、ポスターカラーすら生産はもう終わるだろうと言われています。筆もいい筆が手に入りません。それから紙がこの 1,2 年で急速に悪くなりました。 私はイギリスの B.B. ケントというケント氏をペンで書くときは愛用してたんですが、ついにこのとても素晴らしい僕にとっては宝物のような紙が線をスーッと引くと滲むようになりました。インクが使えなくなりました。何か世界はもっと根元の方でミシミシと悪くなっていくようです。ですからアニメーションのことだけ論じてもしょうがないんじゃないかなと思います。いつでもどうしてこれが流行るのかはよくわからないものが流行ります。もうそれもいろいろあっていいんじゃないかと僕は勝手に思ってます。
In regard to my future work in the animation field, I would like to explain to you that the animation field is changing so dramatically from the world that I knew. The film itself that I used to work with have all disappeared from the industry. We used to work in with cells. We would make little cells, and we don't do that anymore. And many of the paints that we used are no longer available. Some of the paints that we used we call them poster color paints that we used to draw or paint the backgrounds of different films. They are no longer going to be produced very soon. And the brushes, it's very, very difficult to find good brushes nowadays. And the quality of paper has fallen drastically in the last 1 or 2 years. I used to use a pen that was produced by a company called B.B. Kent in the UK, which is wonderful. However, it's with the quality of the paper falling, it's just very, very difficult to use. Even if you can use these pens for a while, the paper quality has fallen so badly that they're no longer usable. So what I'm saying is that something fundamental seems to be changing in the world from the very basic roots of a civilization. Something seems to be changing. So given the enormous changes that are taking place in this field, I think it's kind of almost pointless to try to discuss, the future of animation. And sometimes things become popular in the entertainment world that I do not understand the reasons for their popularity. But then I kind of sit back and think, well, isn't that okay?
How much more time do we have? Joel's got his hand up.
I'm ready to go on as long as you all are.
Joel, if we could at least keep the questions as short as we can for the final few minutes, yeah?
Yes, Joël Legendre, French TV5 and RTL Radio, Midi One. You have spent some money for the kids in Okinawa, and that's my question about Okinawa future as a geography place, as a place where we could imagine another area than military bases. What is your view of what could be Okinawa? Let me just do a quote, a very good story. Some grandparents of friends of mine in Okinawa have been able to get a refuge during the bombing of Okinawa in 45, thanks to some caves deep. And in these caves, there was some water and they could survive for weeks and weeks. These caves are based in what is today Futenma. So my question is, what would you like to see in the future of Okinawa as a place for tourists or real estate? What is your vision? Is there a world of Miyazaki in Okinawa tomorrow?
はい、フランスのテレビでございます。沖縄の子どもたちのために何かいろいろ寄付していると伺っているのでございますが、今後その基地がなくなったりあるいは縮小されて、あんまり軍事的なプレゼンスが少なくなって小さくなりましたら、沖縄はどういうような県になると思いますでしょうか。どのようなその未来が可能になると思いますでしょうか。一つの案でございます。一つのストーリーでございますが、私 の友人 の曽祖父たちが沖縄出身なんでございますが、1945年沖縄戦が行われた時には洞窟に逃げたために命拾いしたわけでございます。でそこにもたくさん水もあった、水があったから生き延びた、というふうにも言ってるわけでございます。でそこの洞窟は逃げた洞窟は今普天間基地のその下になってるわけでございますが、こういうようなものもありますし、またその不動産業っていうのが発達するということも考えられますし、あるいは観光業も考えられますが、宮崎ワールドというものを考えますと、どういう沖縄を想像できますでしょうか。
僕は沖縄は日本と中国と両方仲良くするところになるといいと思います。それが一番ふさわしいです。そして交易をする、それから非常におおらかな心を持っている人たちですから、ちゃんとやっていける島だと思います。随分前です。自分の子供たちが小さかった時に私は2度ほど沖縄の小さな島に行きました。 その時の、あの宿のおじさんとおばさんがどれほど子供たちにいい印象を与えたか、かくもおおらかで優しい人々がいるんだっていうのが、あの驚くべきことでした。本当に2度目の時は僕はあの10人子供を、大人は僕1人で連れて行きました。それで10人は4家族の子供たちですが、みんないつもは喧嘩している兄弟がいつも姉さんや兄さんの言うことをきちんと聞いて、そのおばさんに本当に関心な子供たちだと褒められました。あの沖縄を思い出すといつもその人たちのことを思います。
I believe that Okinawa has a great potential of becoming a place where Japanese and Chinese people can find harmony and peace and friendship. I think that is the most wonderful role that Okinawa could play in the future of these two countries. And the reason that they can play this role is that the people of Okinawa are basically people with great, generous, kind, and gentle hearts. I think, therefore, with their wonderful personalities, with their wonderful sort of characters, I think this is an island or group of islands that will be able to have a very bright future for years to come. Many, many years ago, when my children were small, I visited Okinawa twice. I visited actually some small islands, and I remember staying at a particular sort of hostel, not exactly a hotel, but a hostel that was run by a middle-aged couple. And even now, I am overwhelmed when I think of how kind and generous and how big-spirited they were. They were tremendously kind to my children, and they were so kind to my children that the second time I visited, I was the only adult, and I took 10 children from 4 different families with me. And these children normally would fight all the time amongst themselves, but under the influence of this wonderful couple, they became very, very well behaved. The younger children would listen to what the older children would say, and the lady of the hostel said, they are such lovely children, but it was because of her and her husband that they became such lovely children. Even now, I think back to, whenever I think of Okinawa, I think of this couple.
Teddy, and then this gentleman behind, and then Martin. And I think we'll need to wind it up then, yeah?
すみません、ありがとうございます。ビデオニュースの神保です。辺野古基金の共同代表の宮崎監督にお伺いしたいんですが、政府は、辺野古に基地が作れないとなると、危険な状態になる普天間の固定化につながるというような、脅しとも取れるような、言い方を繰り返しています。宮崎監督としましては、この辺野古問題というのはの解決策、どのような形で解決されるべきだとお考えでしょうか。
So going back to your position as the joint representative of the Hinoko Fund, the government has taken this a very strong position, saying that if we cannot build a replacement facility in Hinoko, then there is no choice but to fix or keep Futenma in its current location. It can be taken almost as a threat, this government's stance. But what is your response? How do you think this problem should be resolved?
Futenma の基地は移転しなければいけません。それから辺野古を埋め立てるのはいけません。それで第一次民主党の内閣の鳩山総理は、日本全体で負担しようというふうに発言したんです。僕はそれがまだ生きていると思ってます。
I believe very clearly, very strongly, that Futenma should be moved out of its current location. And I also believe just as strongly that Hinoko facility should not be built. In other words, the beautiful coral, that beautiful ocean should not be reclaimed. I believe that the promise or the declaration that was made by Prime Minister Hatoyama, who was the head of the first Democratic Party of Japan cabinet, who said that all of Japan should bear this burden of the U.S. bases, not just Okinawa. I believe that this promise is still in effect. It is still very much alive.
The gentleman behind you, yeah.
中国のチャイナニュースサービスのものですが、ちょっと質問がありますけれど、監督の作品の中でですね、いくつかそういう直接戦争を触れたという作品が、名作があるわけですから、今年ちょうど戦後7周年という節目の年なんですけれども、監督から見ればですね、あの戦争、あれは70年前のあの歴史は一体どういうものなんでしょうか。それと、あれから どういう教訓あるいは経験得られるものかと、そういうことなんです。
I'm from the China News Service, and in regard to your works, there are many parts, there are many aspects of your work that touch upon the Great War of 70 years ago. The fact that we are in this 70th anniversary year makes me ask this question. From your point of view, what exactly happened some 70 years ago? What was all of that about? What were the lessons learned? What were the experiences gained?
あの戦争に至る前どこで止められたんだろうというふうによく考えます。そうするとだんだん遡っていってついに日本とロシアの戦争にまで至ります。実はその前に日清戦争というのもありますが、これは結局東アジアにヨーロッパが来て大砲で開国を迫ったことによるんです。文明の衝突から始まったんですね。でもそれを言っていくとどんどん責任が曖昧になります。ですから僕はやっぱりやってはいけないことはやってはいけないんだということしかないんじゃないかと思います。他国を自国のために犠牲にして侵略することは絶対あってはならない。どんな理由をくっつけてもそれどんなに美化しても美化しきれない。その原則だけは絶対守るべきであるというふうに思います。侵略してはいけないんです。それで私たちは島国ですから一番やりやすいはずです。
Before the war occurred, the Great War, World War II occurred, I sometimes think back to the history before that. At what point in history, at what point in the series of events that led up to this terrible ending, could something have been done to stop Japan from becoming embroiled in this war? If you go back and back and back in history, you go back maybe perhaps to the Russo-Japanese War, but before that you have the Sino-Japanese War, and before that you have the reality that the great powers of Europe had used their military might, cannonball diplomacy, to make inroads into East Asia. And in other words, it all began with a clash of civilizations back then. But if we continue along this kind of reasoning, trying to find justifications, trying to find who was in the wrong, et cetera, et cetera, eventually the responsibilities borne by different parties throughout history become vague. It's difficult to pin down responsibilities. So I think what should be done by everyone is to stop that trying to find justifications in the past and say, that one should live by fundamental principles, which is that there are things that one should never do. One should never engage in wars of aggression against other countries to pursue one's own interest. And that is all that needs to be done. And if we can live by this policy, that is enough. And being an island country, that should be very easy for Japan to do.
All right. I think we'll take one more question. Is that okay? And Martin has had his hand up for a while.
I remain seated now because I would block the camera, I guess. You were talking about the future of animation, or better, you were not talking much about the future of animation. But I would like to ask you exactly the question. Where do you see the future of animation? You are a specialist for these long feature films, feature animation. There are other new companies also from Japan, like Dreamlink Entertainment, that produce very rapid, very minimalist animation. They react very rapidly, quickly to the demands, the suggestions of their viewers. Do you think that this is basically the new way, this very close contact with the viewers? Or do you think that the long feature film that takes years to produce, that's a high-risk undertaking, has a future too?
先ほどその世の中は非常に変化しておりますので、そのアニメーションの将来を論じるのはどうかということをおっしゃっていたのでございますが、でもしかしそれについて質問させていただきたいと思います。アニメーションの今後はどうお考えになってますでしょうか。つまり監督は長編作に今まで特化してきたわけでございますが、今は新しい会社、例えばドリームリンクエンターテインメントなどがありますが、これは非常に機敏にその 視聴者 の, その要望にニーズに応えられて、すぐ何か作品を作れるというような会社なのそうでございますが、これがアニメーション の, その未来像になると思いますでしょうか。それとも今まで監督が関わってきた非常にその長い映画、まあ、その制作するのに何年もかかって非常にハイリスク、しかしながらハイリターンも期待できる、こういうような映画にも未来があると思いますでしょうか。
幸運と才能さえあればなんとかなるでしょう。
If you have tremendous luck and you also have tremendous talent, yes, there might be a possibility for you in this field.
Well, thank you so much, not only for being so forthright and for hosting such an open, uncommonly open press conference. I don't think any of us have ever seen a press conference like this. But also for extending the time by 15 or 16 minutes. That was very kind of you. The director told us that he doesn't like to come into Tokyo, and who can blame him, but we hope that he will come back to the club sometime soon and host a similar press conference and tell us what he's up to. So that's why we offer him a year's membership of the club. Would you be kind enough to show your appreciation to the director? Thank you.
The director has just one thing to say to everyone. This room is smoking allowed.
You can take a photo. Thank you.